नमस्कार गणेश जी, वेलकम टू अहिंसा कॉन्वर्सेशंस. सो एज विद एवरीवन एल्स, व्हाट इज योर अर्लीस्ट रिकॉलेक्शन और मेमोरी ऑफ द कॉन्सेप्ट और द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ अहिंसा?
Well, the earliest I remember is when I was very young, about 3.5 or 4 years old. When I was very, very young, I was in a village and neighborhood people used to gather in the evenings. There was no television and even radio did not come to that village by then. So chit-chat was a very great social obligation. I heard conversation among elders which was about what happened when Gandhi was killed. On that day, that evening, the news came to my village a couple of hours after it had reached Pune through radio, and people from my village who were in Pune had returned to the village, and some houses were burnt the next day. They were set on fire. These were houses of Brahmins. Now, the Brahmin families continued to live in that village, and the families that had torched these houses also continued to live in that village. It was a small village. And so a reconciliation was necessary. I heard my elders, this is not in 48, but in 53, 54, 4 or 5 years later, I heard my elders talking about who gave food to whom that evening. These were simple things, but that made a very deep impression on my mind. That even during riots, arson, hatred, the families from one side were providing food to families, food and shelter to families from the other side. I thought this was non-violence. So after that, I did not have to think again as to what non-violence is. I did not learn about the word or the meaning of the word through bulky books, but through real life conversation based on action and memories of the people. I'm sure this happened to millions who experienced the partition or to lakhs who experienced riots in various parts of the country.
Yes. Yes, indeed. As we both know, that this is what Ashish Nandi's study on partition violence has in fact documented. Later on, as a professor, you did a great deal of in-depth study on Sri Aurobindo. How did that shape your understanding of the dynamic between violence and non-violence?
See, my interest in Sri Aurobindo was primarily emerging from construction of a very long poem called Savitri. And I was very curious as to how he visualized, how he conceptualized an epic that is not like the Mahabharata, though founded on the Mahabharata, an epic that is very much like Milton's Paradise Lost, though not founded upon the Paradise Lost. So my interest in Sri Aurobindo was to see the synthesis of cultures and this idea of synthesis of yoga, synthesis of culture, synthesis of different historical times, synthesis of visions, synthesis of religious views, that attracted me in him. There is another Sri Aurobindo in existence, belonging to an earlier time when he was in the middle of a popular movement in West Bengal, where his language was the kind of language that today might make anybody slightly, self-aware. Because all the terminology, there's Matru Mandir, Mother India, so the Bankim Chandra Chatterjee's saffron clad, Swamiji who becomes a patriot, and all those were images in Sri Aurobindo's thought and writing, but not with the same associations with which they are paraded today. So, Sri Aurobindo's idea of a universal man, a universal consciousness, going beyond a single culture, that attracted me. So I thought that synthesis of views, synthesis of civilizations, synthesis of cultures, synthesis of religious ideas is the material of nonviolence. My village told me what nonviolence as practice is. Sri Aurobindo told me what nonviolence as material is, as substance is. For example, there is an epic, not known, not much known, that he wrote before he wrote his Savitri, before he published his Savitri, and that is based on the, that is depiction of the last day of the Trojan, the war at Troy. It is called, it is called Ilion. It is close to the Iliad. It is the city of Ilion, the sun city. And everywhere there is destruction. And yet Aurobindo could see in that destruction emergence of something new. So he found life in death rather than death in life. And I thought nonviolence is always a search for life in death. That is the substance of nonviolence that Sri Aurobindo gave to me without my understanding that I was receiving it from him.
Mm. You have also looked very closely at the many ways in which the Bhagavad Gita is interpreted in the first half of the 20th century. And how central that is to our whole journey, both for the struggle for freedom and then the building of a free India. So would you like to speak about that? Particularly since you have noted that, I think this you say is your understanding of the Gita, that violence that is a product of ignorance is as ignoble as non-violence. Now, that's a challenging statement.
From the end of the 18th century, the Gita acquired a new significance because it started appearing in the English language. And therefore, it's the domain, is sociological domain change. It was earlier a part of the Sandhya part for traditional Brahminical classes, the upper caste. But it had to be recited in the evening. From the end of the 18th century, the Bhagavad Gita acquired a new sociological class in India. It was the English knowing class. And it was also the class that was trying to bring India close to modernity. It was also the class that was trying to bring some kind of freedom to India. Though the ideas of modernity and ideas of freedom were not fully defined. So throughout the 19th century, there were repeated versions of the Gita appearing in English with different interpretations. Swami Vivekananda also gave one translation and interpretation of the Gita using Shankaracharya, the Adi Shankara's commentary on the Gita. Gita Bhashya of Shankara was translated by Vivekananda into English. And so at the beginning of the 20th century, one finds that practically every social leader of some significance has had some take on the Gita. It's probably a parallel would be in the second half of this 20th century, every social leader had some take on Karl Marx. So Gita for the early 20th century India was what Marx was for the second half of the 20th century India, sociologically speaking, not philosophically speaking. So we have a commentary by Mahatma Gandhi. He has also translated some of the Gita, his lectures on the Gita. We have a commentary by Lokmanya Tilak called the Gita Rahasya. There are essays on the Gita by Arvind Ghosh and any number of other leaders, social thinkers are talking about the Gita. Interpreting it in its own ways. Tilak interpreted it as a thesis on Kruti, Karma Yoga. Karma not in the metaphysical karma sense, but in the sense of action, obligation, duty. Aurobindo looked at it as a book where knowledge is at the center and evolution of the consciousness is at the center. And Gandhi looked at it as a book which foregrounds bhakti or devotion or dedication to one's work. All these three possibilities exist within the Gita, because the Gita, the Bhagavad Gita that we know as the Gita, is a collection. It is an anthology of thought. It is not a thought. It is not a philosophy. It is a collection of thoughts, which probably for several centuries were being collected. And later, sometime in the 10th century, they were put into the main text of the Mahabharata as part of a conversation that took place at the war field. The original style of Vyasa is very racy. Vyasa has no time to stop, dwell on a single action or single point in action and dilate on that and dwell on that and describe it. He's in great rush because he's covering a vast plot, vast stretch of time. The Gita was brought into it sometime in the 10th century as the Bhagavad Gita, and it is a collection of various philosophical views. So it has some lines from Upanishads, some lines from the Rig Veda, some which are dramatic compositions that Vyasa might have added or some others might have added. Therefore, if the Mahabharata war was fought for 18 days, over 18 days, Mahabharata had 18 parvas, the Gita had to have 18 adhyayas to look consistent with the book, because it was being planted into it in the right sense. Now, what is the Gita's take on the war? That's a big question. The answer is, yes, the Gita justifies the war. Then one needs to be a bit, one needs to rethink about the Gita. But the war had taken place, and the war was depicted in the Mahabharata, and the Mahabharata existed. The Gita had no choice but to get a foothold in that book and present a philosophy of life. Therefore, in its presentation, within the Bhagavad Gita's presentation, the war receives a justification because that is the entry point for the Gita into the Mahabharata, historically. But having done that, does Krishna of the Gita say that the purpose of life is to fight and destroy? Or does he say the purpose of life is to fight, win the war and enjoy, or fight, be famous and be eternally known? That man is saying, the Lord Krishna of the Bhagavad Gita is saying, that you can enjoy fame, eternity, immortality, kingdom, everything by getting ready to sacrifice of the Isha Upanishad is the essence of the Gita. He says, Karmanye Vadikarasya Ma Phaleshu Kadachan. Yeah, you do your duty. Don't abandon your duty. Duty must be done. But you must be ready to think of the fruit of that duty as not yours. Tena taktena vi. Then your duty is fully performed duty. That's the overall meaning of the Gita as I read it. But there are elements in the Gita which make me uneasy. For instance, the caste system, the Varna system, endogamy, exogamy, those issues are raised in the discussion. Arjuna is saying that if I get into this war, there will be a kulakshaya. It will be the end of my race. It will be end of my community and caste. And how can I allow that, etc. I don't like those parts, frankly, from my 21st century perspective. Be ready to act, but do not look at the fruits of the action as yours. So, aparigraha of Gandhi is what makes me like the Gita of Lord Krishna.
That's right. And is this the central reason why Gandhiji is able to read the Gita and take from it a message for nonviolence? Or is there more to that?
No, that is not the central reason. The central reason is not in the Gita. The central reason is within Gandhiji. Because he could take from the Bible, he could take from Tolstoy, he could take from Ruskin, he could take from Raja Harishchandra, a play that he saw, he could take from Quran, and therefore he could take from the ordinary people. He was extremely receptive. And therefore he received this message from the Gita, just as when he wrote on the Isha Upanishad, he said, if all the scriptures disappear, at least this must remain. And if all of it disappears, at least the first shloka, first verse must remain. And then he quotes it, which is this, you can be the master of all the words if you are ready to give up all the words. Aparigraha. That is, Gandhiji learned the Gita much late in his life. He was not an impressionable boy when he started learning the Gita. He had already gone to South Africa. He was already in the second phase of his stay in South Africa when he started committing the Gita to his memory verse by verse by sticking the shloka along the mirror and while brushing his teeth every morning. So he was brushing his teeth and trying to memorize a shloka after another shloka from the Gita. He was not in his teens or in his 20s. He was in his 30s. And he was already politically sav. He was already a well-made activist. He was a learned lawyer. It is at that stage that the Gita... So the Gita endorsed Gandhiji's own realization about life. It is not that the Gita affected his life. He received it because it was consistent. And therefore, Gandhi did not justify the war in the Mahabharata. Gandhi speaks of the Mahabharata as an epic, which tells us about the vision of life, which has to be broad enough to accept everybody. Therefore, he says it is a national epic. Thank you.
These verses that he then recited every day for the rest of his life, which I believe have mostly to do with the notion of, with the concept of the Sthita Pragya Purush. Can you say if there was a connection between that, which he chose to recite on a daily basis, and his further development of the practice of nonviolence?
Yes, but it is not about Sthita Pragna and Uttam Purusha Yoga and all that. It is the bond between oneself and one's soul. Where, you know, there is a verse in the Gita which says, Nainam Chindanti Shastrani Nainam Dahati Pavaka. What is within you cannot be killed by weapons, cannot be burned by fire, cannot be destroyed by fire. I think Gandhi learned this. Gandhi acquired the still-like will to fight as an activist under the impact of that, and that the guns of the British would not be able to kill him. That was straight from the Gita. Because he said, the most you can do is to take my body, but not me. That is from the Gita. Not about Uttam Purusha or Sita Pradnya or Brahmacharya. Those are not things that he learned from the Gita. He was trying to devise mechanics of organizing people. And there, whatever became necessary, he brought it to the service of his great mission. That is my understanding. I may be wrong.
Ji, no. Is that or something similar that has empowered you to, you know, put yourself at risk in the way that you have, because you have stepped away from your scholarly work to become a full-time activist, challenging violence on the ground. You moved to Dharwad as a tribute almost to Professor Kalburgi, who was killed a year earlier. So can you say, what are your sources of strength of standing up to violence?
I was in Gujarat for 35 years. And Gandhiji was very much in the air. The Sabarmati Ashram was almost next door in Ahmedabad. Dandi was only 2 hours away from my Baroda city. But in the initial years, I did not feel attracted to Gandhiji. And I do not recall any conscious efforts I made to go close to Gandhi. But I must say, he was very eager to come close to me. And you know, like you are looking at the sky to very bright stars. So my Derrida was a star, my Marx was a star, my Freud was a star, my Aurobindo was a star. But when you look at the stars, you forget that the sky is there. Gandhi was like that sky. I was looking at the stars and the sky was looking at me. So every time a turning point came in my life, somehow he jumped through the window or came through the door unseen by me. I held my hand and took me in a direction that my life took. I'll give you one or two examples very quickly. After I finished the People's Linguistic Survey of India, I wanted to offer the entire work because it was massive. 35,000 pages. I wanted to dedicate it to the nation. I was discussing with friends as to what we should do. And a suggestion came, why don't we go to the place where Gandhi was killed? Surely some blood drops, fell on that ground. Why don't we put our books there so that they become part of his blood? And that's what we did. I did not go to Rashtrapati or Pantapradhan. We went to Tish January Marg in Delhi. And my soul felt very restful when I did that. Similarly, this tribal academy which was created, all other professors and so on, and it would have been quite natural for me to sit there, hold on to that institution for till I am dead and gone and even beyond. But somebody whispered in my ears that you see, this old man has spoken about trusteeship, and what comes from public funds must go to the public. So at the age of 60, I decided that I'll not be a trustee, I'll leave the place to the care of the Adivasis there. there was not even an iota of unease in my mind. So it was because of Gandhi. Not because of Gandhi I decided to study and learn, but Gandhi who decided to study me and guide me. Ahimsa is creative. It is generative. It has a strange and mysterious way of perpetuating itself through many lives. I don't think Gandhi was a greatly original thinker. But Gandhi was, as I said at the beginning, he was able to receive from many, many quarters. And he opened himself up to receiving what Mahavir had said about aparigraha. Because Gandhi's analysis of violence is greed generates violence. Aparigraha is the foundation for ahimsa, which he received from Srimad Ramchandra, who had received it from earlier Jain gurus and Mahavir. He received it from Buddha to take a katora in his hand and go off the palace. As Siddharth did, this barrister could take the tie and the coat off and move about half naked. That was the foundation of his ahimsa. He was able to receive. Therefore, the ahimsa, which is there eternally as the law of nature, visits a mind. So in my case, I made myself at least half ready, not fully ready, half ready to receive. And so ahimsa that was there in Mahavir or Buddha or Gandhi or Nanak or Tukaram or Kabir came to me. I received it in my crude way. But I do not want to carry it forward and gift it to the next generation. It will move forward because ahimsa is generative. Anybody who wants to receive it will get it.
I am mystified,
but it is a mysterious flow. It is the law of ahimsa is the law of nature, because nature allows nature to grow. Culture destroys nature. And ahimsa is nature. Himsa has to be cultivated consciously. Have you heard of any gadgets for ahimsa? But for himsa, you have to have guns, bombs, aeroplanes. You have to make things to make himsa. But ahimsa, you do not have to make ahimsa. Ahimsa is there like the sky. Sorry.
So is it culture then that has resulted in this enormous violence, which is causing the death of languages? Because that is a big passion on which you have nurtured and through which you have produced such really seminal work.
I think you put two questions to me in your single question. Does culture produce violence? The answer is not. I will not say culture produces violence, but I'll say culture at its early crude phases is close to violence. Culture will have to learn to ward itself off, to keep itself safe from himsa. And the humans have to go a long way before that happens. So we are in the early stages of culture. So it's hardly, because we started speaking only 70,000 years ago. Humans have been speaking only for 70,000 years. Whereas the history of Homo sapiens, maybe it is 20 lakh years or 30 lakh years. So we are in early stages of culture, since culture is possible only through language. Without the basis of language, culture is cognitive processes won't be possible. cultural cognitive processes won't be possible. So in that sense, so we'll have to go a long way, and we will actually have to develop languages of different kind. I mean, just words, but human relationship, because language is a bridge for building human relations, and we'll have to learn to relate to humans differently. We'll have to learn to relate to nature differently, cosmos, relate to cosmos differently. And we'll take a few hundred or few thousand years when we, and at that time, culture won't be destructive of nonviolence. It won't be violent. It will be part of the larger flow of nonviolence. In fact, the maturity of a civilization, maturity of a culture, its ability to be nonviolent.
And do you see the signs of these new languages, this higher, if I may call it, forms of consciousness emerging in your very intensive interactions with young people across the country? I know that now for about 5 years, you have been crisscrossing across India, meeting young people in very intense dialogues. What do you sense is emerging from among them on the issue of violence and nonviolence?
I will give three examples. One is when Me Too came up, movement, young people were there. There was not a shade of violence in the language or the method. And yet it was a liberating movement. Similarly, when in Bangalore, some time back, the BJP government put a ban on music. This is not known widely in India. Some kind of music, they put a ban on that. The young people in Bangalore started doing graffiti on walls. And that graffiti was not violent graffiti. It was very interesting what they wrote. It was not abuse, but it was expression of the self. The third is when the Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act agitation erupted. The lakhs, I mean, I remember having address meetings with 50,000, 1 lakh, 2 lakhs, 110, and so on, in all parts of the country. They had the tricolor in their hands. They had slogans and songs, most famously, Faiz Ahmad Faiz song. Now, there was no abuse in the air, and there was no anger in the assembly. There was agraha, there was nirdhar. Determination and insistence certainly were there. But one never felt intimidated by the presence of lakhs of people. One never felt unsafe. And there were young girls, young boys in those crowds in large numbers. These are the signs of a new kind of society emerging. The new society will move very rapidly to the language of images rather than language of words, because there are deep changes happening in that side of the brain which handles language transactions, the Broca's lobe, left side. Changes are taking place. Fatigue has entered that part, and the prefrontal cortex is now the more active part of the human brain, which is congenial for receiving language of imagery. images, which will free us from constraints of space as well as time. False divisions between the past and the future. Because the language with words has present tense, past tense, future tense. Without those tenses, language, without the mechanism of tenses, human language of words will not be possible at all. But language of images does not have to have the false division of time. Therefore, the new languages will be languages closer to truth of the world. They'll be closer to a better perception, human perception about the phenomenal world. And when humans have a better understanding of what the cosmos is, what the world is, humans will learn to be less violent, less absurd. Absurdity emerges when there's breakdown in communication. When you do not understand another fellow, you go and hit that fellow. When we do not understand the cosmos, we go and destroy the cosmos. But a new understanding will emerge through a new language equipment that humans are acquiring. And therefore, nonviolence has a very long run in this, I will not say life, but in the cosmos, in the possible futures that humans have. This is my understanding. It is not my belief. It is not my hope. But this is what I understood in my limited way, in my limited life. Thank you.
Can you say something about Dakshinayan and why it was set up and what has been happening there? Because it is a stand for nonviolence in a very much deeper sense than I think has often been articulated in the public space.
You see, the writers were being murdered one after the other. And so when the third murder took place, many of us returned our awards, Academy Awards. Some people returned the Padma Shri. Some people returned their Sangeet and Natak Academy Award. I sent my Sahitya Academy Award back in protest. Immediately after that, the propaganda machine of the regime started interpreting this reaction as a part of the Bihar election campaign of the Congress Party, which it was not. So I was thinking to myself, I said, the entire country looks only up to Delhi, the north. What will happen if somebody starts looking to the south? Ignoring Delhi, ignoring the Takht and Taj, and go south. South is also going to the people in the geopolitical, economical sense, the global south. And we all know that, you know, in the part of the earth that we are, when the sun moves towards the north, we have longer days and shorter nights. But when the sun moves to the south, we have longer nights and shorter days. So I wanted to say symbolically that we are in times when our nights are longer and the days are shorter. So that is the time of going south, Dakshinayan. So the writers that assembled around this movement accepted the idea, called this Dakshinayan. And then we visited the families of thinkers who were assassinated. And from many states they came, these writers. So I asked them, if we have to come together, what would be a good place? And lo and behold, all of them said, why don't we go to Dandi? Because that is the place that Gandhi sanctified by showing us the archetypal protest with minimum means, minimum resources, minimum action, maximum results. Just a pinchful of salt, So we went to Dandi. And our resolve there was, be fearless. Nothing more, nothing less. So if somebody says this was a non-violent, you know, this was a kind of another page in the history of non-violence, I will not deny that. But I did not plan it consciously that way. It just happened that everybody said the best thing is to go to Dandi. And Rajmohan Gandhi came there, and you know, every right, and children of Dabolkar and Pansare and Kalburgi, they were there. And they were all talking about brutal killing of their fathers or forefathers. Rajmohan's grandfather, Mahatma Gandhi, and the father of, you know, Hamid's father, and father of Sri Vijay Kalburgi. These were people whose father or grandfather has been killed by a bullet. And they were saying, Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. Imagine the power of Ahimsa. Their idea of Ahimsa was fearlessness. And I thought, going south, when the entire world is moving north, requires a certain degree of fearlessness. So I'm practicing that. I'm practicing non-violence by going south. Dakshinayan is my tapascharya.
Bahut cool. And you are also at the moment president of the Rashtra Seva Dal.
Which I am, yes. Ji. Yes.
And how is what? In what ways is that shaping your work?
Rashtra Seva Dal was born in 1920s. Gandhiji decided to appeal to youngsters to form a group for Seva. That became Seva Dal within the Congress. But many changes took place, and in the 1940s, a more socialistic oriented group of the Seva Dal from the Rashtra Seva Dal. Persons like S.M. Joshi and Madhu Limay and Sane Guruji, they were all involved in that. Seva Dal believes in the idea of constitution, democracy, scientific thought, and equality. Now, these are decent values and ideas for a modern democratic state and society. And so I give my time to, as the national president of Rashtra Seva Dal. It has its work going on in various states, Maharashtra, of course, mainly, but in more recently in Karnataka, in Bihar and UP. Bihar, there has been some work, but it's now spread to Rajasthan and Gujarat, and Nagaland, and Arunachal Pradesh, and Goa, and Kerala. It trains humans to be good humans without being a herd. It is socialism does not imply that humans sink their individuality. There can be a society of good individuals. Rashtra Seva Dal is that variety of socialism.
Beautiful. So in closing, what advice would you give to young people who are seeing the attraction, they feel attracted to nonviolence? But they feel daunted also, and they are sometimes puzzled or even, disheartened about how to cultivate a fearlessness that is also not anger. What are some of the things that ordinary people can do in their daily life to cultivate this, these strengths which are clearly taking you on such a passionate journey?
Well, I have I do not have much of an advice, but in a very serious way, if I were to speak very, very seriously to a large number of young persons, I will say sing and dream. Do not forget to dream when you are in sleep or you are awake, and do not forget to sing when you are awake or asleep. Irrationality is as powerful a way of our cognitive process as rationality is. And music as valuable as thought is. And dreams far superior than realities. So to part ways from stark reality, stark rationality is necessary in order to be human and to be alive. Otherwise, one will go mad. Sing and dream if you want to be non-violent. Those who do not sing and do not dream often end up in the mental ward of violence. Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. As always.